Hello and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. We're very, very excited, Dr. Guan and I, to have our friend and co-resident join us today, Dr. Christian Bowers, who's the Associate Professor of Neurosurgery in the Department of Neurosurgery at the University of New Mexico, where he's also the Program Director for the Neurosurgery residency program. And he's also the director of skull-based surgery and surgical neuro-oncology. Just a little bit of background on Dr. Bowers. He's from the Intermountain West. He grew up in Salt Lake City and actually attended the University of Denver for undergraduate studies, where he played Division I soccer. He was actually pretty good, and we can both attest to it, having played with him. And that he, during the time of his medical student interview, he got offered a chance to try out for Real Salt Lake, an MLS soccer team. He turned that down to try to go into medicine. He's still trying to decide if that was the right decision or not, but I think it was. He went from Georgetown to complete his neurosurgical residency at the University of Utah with Dr. Guan and myself, and received specific specialty training in skull-based brain tumors and cerebrovascular neurosurgery, both at Utah, and then did a post-residency fellowship at the Swedish Neuroscience Institute, part of our Providence system up in Seattle. He initially joined one of our senior faculty members from the University of Utah, Dr. Mike Schmidt, who took over as the chairman at New York Medical College, and he was there, I think, for 3 years. Through this time, he's been incredibly prolific and productive. He's published over 100 scientific articles to date and has given over 40 oral presentations, in addition to winning a multitude of neurosurgical research awards. His primary research focus, which he'll be describing today, are neurosurgical outcomes, in particular, how frailty affects these outcomes in researching all types of neurosurgical complications. I think a big part of this, and I'll speak to it personally, I saw the genuine care that Dr. Bowers has for all of his patients, and that was a big part of his faith growing up, and it showed throughout his residency program with the amount of time that he spent with his patients, especially during the time of very busy neurosurgical practice, neurosurgical training. It's incredibly difficult to do. And it's one of the things I've always admired about him. And I think lent itself well to his current research focus that he's going to be talking about, which has turned into one of the biggest and most important things in medical outcomes research. Providing care to the underserved underserved is a huge tenet of Dr. Bowers' belief. Some of the things he's also done includes building a Spanish-speaking clinic for the uninsured and underinsured during his brief time in New York, and I'm sure he's continuing a lot of those different endeavors in New Mexico. So with that brief introduction, Dr. Bowers, please take it away. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Dr. Sivakumar. Thanks, Dr. Guan. It's good to see both of you. Once I hit 100 publications, I knew what it was like to be Dr. Guan after a week in residency, because him and Dr. Sivakumar were both very prolific and great to work with, and spent a lot of time with both of them, and super proud of both of them and excited to kind of watch what they've been doing there in California. And this is a little bit of a homecoming for me. I was born in Southern California, and in a lot of ways, I wouldn't be here without the Southern California medical system. My mother and father struggled with fertility for 7 years after my older brother was born. And I actually was, my mom's fertility doctor was, she was referred out to Scripps, where I was born, but we lived in Laguna Hills. And my mother finished her nurse practitioner in pediatrics from Cal State University of Long Beach. It looked like 19 miles from you guys. And she was the first nurse practitioner hired by Southern Orange County Pediatric Associates, which when I talked to her yesterday and looked this up, they're still around. And she joined them right after they were started in 1977, worked for Dr. Asner. And, you know, we have roots that run real deep. My wife's from Sacramento. So I had three vacations a year for a week in residency. One was spent kind of catching up on research in January. This was the hard one where we drove across the Nevada desert with the kids to Sacramento. But we always looked forward to coming down to Newport Beach and Orange County and visiting friends and family. So today we're going to talk about frailty neurosciences. And I want to tie it in a little bit. to kind of talk about the Southwestern history, kind of mix it up with the talk, keep things interesting. But this is Marco Steniza. And in the late 16th century, he goes and he says that he finds seven cities of gold of Cibola or El Dorado, another name for it. These golden cities that were allegedly made out of gold inspired Coronado to do this huge trip all through, which I can't even imagine now, let alone be bad enough driving it, but in wagons with people through this land in 1542, until they realized there were no golden cities. They figured that out somewhere across the Great Plains in Kansas, executed the person that had been guiding them, turned back around. And as time went on, they got more and more knowledge of the Southwest. The first map has the Rio Grande flowing into the Gulf of kind of the Baja, you know, Pacific Ocean side. And they have, it looks like Santa Fe and San Diego are just a little, you know, half day's walk. By 1680, this is a map I have hanging in my office. We have the Rio Grande's kind of going the right way. They still got California as an island, which I don't think, at least not literally, it's not an island, but they started figuring that out by this, you know, into the 1700s. They're getting the geography down a little bit better and still got Santa Fe and San Diego a little bit close. We're not quite that close to Southern California, but one of the things I'll kind of touch about again at the end is that, you know, New Mexico, California, the whole entire Southwest has an interesting history and connection. And it's not quite as far apart, even though it may be far apart geographically, there's a lot of shared culture and background, which is interesting. So when you look at this picture, the only thing I don't like about, you know, Zoom is I can't see everybody face to face, but when you look at this picture, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Most people, you know, probably say, you know, old, elderly. But when I was, we're going to talk about that throughout the day, and I think you'll have a different take on it by the end of this. We were born in Southern California. We moved to Seattle, Washington. I did elementary school and junior high there. And then my family's been in Utah for the last 29 years, although I was just there for 6 years before I went to school in Colorado. And then did medical school in DC and came back to Utah for a 7-year residency, then Seattle for a year for fellowship, as well, Dr. Steve Kumar said. And then was in New York for 3 years before this opportunity came up in Albuquerque. And when I was in Salt Lake City, there's a very healthy population that does not, you know, they exercise, they're very active. A lot of them do not, you know, they're not excessive smokers or drinkers or drug users. And during residency at the University of Utah, I started studying these populations and looking at comorbidity indices. And one of the first studies I did was looking at older patients with acute subdural hematomas. I think, and one thing that was interesting is a lot of the literature had said you can't operate on these people or they don't do well. So there's recommendations way back in the 90s and before that you should kind of not intervene on them. But we actually knew that, you know, there's people that were dying, especially in Europe, that weren't being transferred. And if they get transferred, you know, they would do well because they had atrophy and a little more space for these hemorrhages and they could recover. That led to my research year taking a look at a deep dive into our vestibular schwannoma series at the University of Utah and really looking at age, because the literature was all over the place. Some of the papers said, you know, old people do terrible with surgery. Once you hit 65 or 60, you got to radiate everyone with vestibular schwannomas. But there were other, you know, papers that suggested that may not be the case. And what we found is there was no difference in surgical, you know, outcomes, essentially, between older and younger patients. Well, you know, were we lying? Were they lying? You know, as we kind of had suspected at the time, although I didn't know about frailty, we were talking about apples and oranges a little bit. We could both have older patients, but one group could be non-frail or what we call robust. And the other group, you know, was probably frail. And that's why they did worse. This is Hiromo Inada. He's an 89-year-old that does an Ironman. I think I'd die if I did an Ironman now, but this guy does them. You know, he's trying to be the first person in the world's history to do it at age 90, but he is what we call robust. He is not frail. So when you look at this sign of frailty, this is not just talking about older people, because you can be like Hiromu and be very robust and active and strong in older age. You know, this is talking about people that are frail specifically, as opposed to just, you know, being older in age. And I heard a lecture when I was at Swedish that really changed the course of my research plans and kind of the future for me. And that was a talk by an orthopedic spine surgeon from Canada, from British Columbia, named Dr. John Street, who gave a talk on frailty. And we knew that, you know, I'd already known that there was a big wave of older patients coming down the road. If you look on this graph here, showing it a little different way, you know, from the white box 2010 to 2019, you can see that, you know, as you go from 2010 to 2019, the patients that are younger are decreasing. The patients that are older are increasing. So it's a nice way of just showing actually that this is still going on. And I put I give an example here with, you know, Southern California and Albuquerque and New Mexico both have a very large percent change from 2010 to 2020 of older patients. So I'm sure you guys are aware of that, but that's an important point is that the country is getting older and older and having older patients. So, you know, we're going to all be dealing with this. And this is another kind of lecture at the time from Dr. Street at the time showing that, you know, this is not earth-shattering science, but as you get older, you tend to have more problems with your health. And frailty is a deficit accumulation occurrence that happens with age, and that, you know, health problems become more common as you age. People tend to be more frail on a whole. And this was from the Canadian Population Health Survey. So what is frailty exactly? Well, one way to think of it is disability, someone being independent, dependent. And if someone has a minor illness, let's say a urinary tract infection, they take this little, you know, green spike, they're still independent the whole time. They take a little bit of a hit. So that's, let's say, you know, a frail person or a healthy person, a robust person has a minor illness, not a big deal. Now, if a frail person has a minor illness, maybe that takes them into this dependent, you know, portion or temporary disablement portion. They don't tolerate, insults as well. This is a kind of a similar graph showing us, you know, the same kind of thing. You get a minor change in health status. Well, if you're robust, you know, gives you a little bit of a hit, but if you have a major change in health status, you know, it can affect you even more. And what we're trying to avoid is if you get a major change in health status and you're a frail person, you don't want to be in this disabled or even permanently disabled group, or, you know, even worse, death or, you know, major issue. Now, when it comes to frailty, it makes sense to me that when you're talking about invasiveness, frailty is going to matter more for the open thoracotomy, you know, in the emergency room, than it is probably in the dermatology clinic, you know, removing a skin lesion or a mole. So I think that is something to think about when we're talking about frailty as well, is what's the extent of the intervention and how does that affect things? So, you know, if it's a minor stress or maybe the skin tag removal, maybe frailty matters a little bit less than it does if you're, you know, frail and you're having this huge intervention, that major, you know, insult. It's where that reservative patient has can make the difference as to whether they come back to independence or stay disabled or have a worse outcome. This is another slide from Dr. Street, talking about frailty. And you can talk about a lot of different components to it. Primary health goes into it. And it's really about our reserves, what comorbidities we have. And then there's markers you can study, you know, for it, looking at physical manifestations of the frailty, you know, how strong people are, their endurance, cognitive abilities, and so forth, their overall mobility. And then looking at different adverse outcomes when you're in the bottom of this, when you're into this area. Is it, you know, permanent disability, temporary, you know, institutionalization, or even death? Just from Lancet publication 2014. So I think this is a good way of thinking about it. The more frail people are, the more likely minor illnesses are going to affect them and put them into this dependent mode, either temporarily or permanent. And so by being robust, we have the most amount of reserve. We can handle the most amount of insults. And we don't want to be down here. You know, you don't want your patients down there. So this is kind of a good way to think about it going forward. And something that really, when I heard that lecture towards the end of my fellowship year, and during that year, and I had kind of was formulating how I was going to start research as we got to this into my new job as an attending. And I found this paper shortly thereafter that was kind of like the promise of what this frailty kind of concept could be. And that is, they just took, you know, single institution took 150 melanoma brain met patients, newly diagnosed. And all they did was measure the temporalis muscle. And the temporalis muscle thickness was an independent predictor of survival for these patients. So this is the frail group over here in the blue bar, and the green group on the right, that's the robust group. The blue group is the frail group. And just by measuring the temporalis thickness, that in that case, the sarcopenia or muscle mass loss was a marker of how people were going to do. Now that doesn't always hold true, but that was the kind of the promise of how cool this research could be and how helpful it could be in predicting outcomes. So sarcopenia is just one example, and it tends to happen more as people get older. And you can see sarcopenia with, you know, at any age, resulting from other problems, inflammatory diseases, malnutrition, et cetera. But it's one component that can be present in frail patients and is tend to be seen more in older patients. Now, when it comes to frailty scales, how do we measure how frail somebody is? It turns out surgeons think they're really good at looking at somebody and talking to them and figuring it out, but they're actually not very good when you look at studies that look at that. So there's a clinical frailty scale, which seems, you know, good. You have you can kind of tell the difference, everybody can, between someone that's terminally ill and someone that's very fit. But when we're trying to do data, you know, studies and research, we really want more quantitative measures than qualitative measures that way. The problem is you got to have something that is gonna be able to be implemented quickly. If you have children or you're around little children, then you may know who Flash is.
Well, I was hoping you could run a play for us. We are in a really big hurry.
Sure. What's the plate?
29 T
number.
29THD03.
I can't even watch it. I speak too fast and I'm always in too big of a hurry. I'm like the bunny. But this is the 70-item Canadian Study on Health and Aging Frailty Index. We don't have time as clinicians. We're busy. We don't have time to go through 70 different, you know, health scores with people. Speaking, it looks like I might be getting a delay.
The 70 items are up now. Christian, go ahead and unmute yourself. Is Louisa running the PowerPoint or are you, Christian?
Oh, we just lost him. He was actually on two different computers. And yeah. I'm wondering if playing that video might have stalled things up for him.
He's so just going to restart and come back in. So we apologize. Dr. Bowers will go ahead and restart this video shortly. As we're getting this up and running, if we can remind everyone, if you have any questions, this is most certainly going to be a very thought-provoking discussion. Please type them into the Q&A box, and we will go over all of the questions at the end of the presentation.
Do you want me to pause the recording, doctor?
Please.
We need a frailty scale that is something that people can actually use clinically. And you don't have a ton of time when you are evaluating patients. Is that appropriate place to pick back up? Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead.
Right, we're gonna skip the video. So when we can't take 70 items, even though this correlates with outcomes, and there's a good study they've done with this. You can't take 70 items and run through that with patients. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't work. Even if it's very predictive and it's the best scale in the world. Now, this is a fantastic paper and these people were super smart and they took those 70 variables and they used the NSQIP, National Surgical Quality Improvement Program database, and they found what variables out of those 70 were available. And they found that there were 11 that they could use. Now, the nice thing about this is you are no longer having to go through charts or, you know, fill all this out to get your frailty score. So this is modified frailty index, 11 variables, and you just take each variable, you get a point if the patient has that, and you score patients all the way up using that. If it ends up being that you guys are having trouble hearing me, let me know and I can log in on my phone for the audio. Now, in 2015, there was no big scientific breakthrough. The NSQIP database natural, they just on their own, they quit collecting those 11 variables and they went to five variables, the MFI5. So when we're talking about frailty, this is what a lot of the literature, myself included, have been using to publish. But in a sense, this may not, you know, be the best measure of how frail somebody is. It can be a measurement of a comorbidity index, pretty simple one, of just five variables. So keep that in mind, we'll come back to that. So when I got to New York, I was you know, charged with building the research at our department. I was a brand new attending. And I had this kind of this vision after this talk of how I wanted the next, you know, several years of my research to go. And I knew that the first start, since there was nothing really written on neurosurgery, was to first just evaluate the literature. And then I would write then these, it was MFI 11 initially, you know, these papers, kind of defining what this was in neurosurgery, because I'd already started that with acoustics and with subdurals. And I kind of knew that part about writing about older versus younger patients, but I knew I wanted to define what frailty was for the key neurosurgical pathologies. And so the first step, even though it took a little while to get published, but this is what we started with, was just taking, you know, a review of frailty in neurosurgery, looking at the data, and it turned out there hadn't been very much published. There was 25 kind of up to that point. And the vast majority of that was, you know, in spine. And then there was the cranial work in particular was pretty limited. One spontaneous ICH, a chronic subdural study, a GBM study, and then a couple, you know, mix and on tumor. So that's when we started. That's kind of all there was. It's a breakdown of it kind of in pie chart form. And then the definitions of frailty were all over the place. What was, you know, frail, what people were classifying as non-frail. These are just three different examples of what in the small sample of papers, there wasn't a common language about how to measure it. So there was plenty of work to do. And I kind of figured I'd spend the next, you know, half a decade, maybe, you know, maybe for longer than that, working all of this out. But starting with this very blunt tool, which I kind of recognized wasn't the best, you know, frailty scale in the world. So we started looking, using frailty to kind of look at outcomes. And the nice thing about that is, you know, that whenever you look at something with frailty in neurosurgery, you're generally going to have publishable data because it's an important topic, population's aging, people follow that logic. And so we started with vestibular schwannomas and looking at frailty, we showed that it was actually the amount of frailty and not the age, which resulted in longer lengths of stay. So it's a start, but it was still an important finding that it was the amount of, you know, how frail patients were. And if they had one of those, if they had none of those variables, they were zero, they were robust. If they had one, we called them, you know, pre-frail, two or more, you know, was frail in our group, but those patients stayed longer. And it wasn't because we know there was these old healthy people. It wasn't just age which determined that. Sounds obvious, but, you know, at the time it hadn't really been shown. Then we started looking at, you know, frailty and how it affected transfers. And we showed that, you know, part of what was going on with transfers was that it was frail patients that tended to get transferred. In addition to, you know, being complex surgically, we had to come up with a spine complexity scoring system, and looked at that along with frailty, and we were able to publish that, you know, that it was the frailty and the complexity, which is what was driving that. So then when I go back and look at our research, you know, we started by looking at, you know, does age matter? And that was what I'd done during, you know, during residency and had shown that it was okay. Age didn't end up making a difference. But then we started moving on with these studies, looking at frailty for each topic. So this, we started looking at angio-negative subarachnoid hemorrhages. Well, it turns out with those that frailty actually predicted outcomes, you know, better than Hunt-Hessen-Fisher score did in terms of, you know, what how people ended up doing clinically. And that was pretty, you know, exciting for us. We were able to present that at the CNS meeting in San Francisco. When you look at these rock curves, you know, the blue boxes here is your Hunt-Hess score. And the better your scale is you're proposing, the more you want it to kind of follow this upper left curve. And the worse it is, it's going to be more just like this red dotted line. Doesn't mean there's no significance there. So really the frailty really outperformed Hunt-Hess and Fisher with angio-negative subarachnoid hemorrhages for mortality and even for discharge to home. And that was kind of the first big paper that said, okay, well, we can actually really change how people think about some of these diseases by looking at this. And so we were able to publish that and you know, really validate the use of frailty for these patients, at least based on some retrospective data we had. We started looking at aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, and we found with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, it wasn't as powerful. And so that kind of, you know, was interesting to us. And so we realized too, it wasn't necessarily going to be a slam dunk like that first angio-negative subarachnoid hemorrhage paper. We were going to start looking at everything and see where did older age matter more or less. I'd known from my research with subdurals early on as a resident, that it didn't really matter how old or young someone was if both their pupils were blown, you know, for a long period of time. So there are other factors, but we wanted to start defining this. How about ICHs? This goes into our, you know, neuroscience topic today. Does the modified frailty index predict mortality? Well, it turns out that the ICH score is already pretty strong and pretty good. Then we started looking at different frailty indices. We used MFI 11, 5, looked at temporal muscle thickness, Charleston comorbidity index. The MFI 5 and 11 were better at predicting discharge home and, you know, mortality rates, but you know, there was other information that could be gleaned from these other scales. So this ended up being just when we started doing this, I got to New York the kind of summer of 2017, and this was kind of our focus, was to look at frailty for all these major topics, acute subdural hemorrhage, you know, and then we did a project looking at odontoid fractures, which is great. Any disease that's kind of predominantly confined to older patients is super, you know, good to look at. And odontoid fractures are one that is a perfect one to look at in elderly patients. And this actually won the research award of the big general surgery trauma meeting, showing that, you know, frailty was an independent risk factor for increased complication rates, longer hospital stays in odontoid fracture patients. In October of the year before, the neurosurgery focus had their first kind of cranial, you know, edition focused on older patients. And so, you know, we comment on that. And we also, you know, submitted a different paper that got published there that I'll show in a second on meningiomas. We looked at frailty affecting outcomes following chronic subdural hemorrhages. And, you know, and how did that affect things? So although frailty was associated with worse surgical outcomes, you know, GCS was still better. And actually in that case, the Charleston comorbidity index was, you know, more helpful for figuring out ultimate disposition. We looked at spinal epidural abscess patients. We compared them, their frailty scores to just other patients that were case control matched who came in with back pain. And just to compare how that difference was. And you know, it wasn't a big surprise, but we were able to characterize that, you know, these spinal epidural abscess patients had increasing frailty and that they actually did worse as well. They tended to not be discharged to home. Even within all the spinal epidural abscess patients, those that were more frail within that group did worse. So we spent those first couple of years kind of setting up these studies and knowing we're going to use MFI 5 and 11 studies for, you know, the major neurosurgical diseases. I think we're around 20 publications now, got about another 50 kind of in the works or people working on it. But that was just the first step of what I'd kind of envisioned to be in the next 10 plus years, you know, research. The really exciting part, and what I think is more looking at true frailty instead of what I think the MFI 5 and 11 are, you know, more like comorbidity indices, was this risk analysis index. And that kind of coincided with me coming over from New York to New Mexico. Our new quality officer that was starting here is a younger surgeon, and she's amazing, Dr. Rahini McKee. And so her and I had started talking about risk analysis index and incorporating that for the whole hospital and surgery. And she had learned this within general surgery and trauma from Dr. Dan Hall and Dr. Jason Johanning. And we'll kind of get to them. When I was looking at neurosurgery focus, this was this other paper started looking at brain tumors especially. And this was the first kind of paper on meningiomas showing that frailty could predict worse outcomes. And it was an independent risk factor for worse outcomes, including increased length of stay, worse discharge disposition. And we had a lot of patients that were older that had, you know, meningiomas. And as you get more and more frail, you know, your length of stay increased significantly. And I don't think that was a major surprise, but it was nice to show that. And that was true for, you know, where they were discharged to, whether they were readmitted as a complication, and their length of stay overall was longer. So not a huge surprise, but it was good to show that, you know, the MFI could at least predict that and give you some ideas to how to counsel people that you're operating on. We then took this was a single center series in New York that was small. It was single center, and it was you know, 75 plus patients. But we then took a large data set. And this is when I started using, you know, larger data sets to study this, and looked at 20,000 patients. And we showed that, you know, frailty was better at predicting complications, clavia and dindo grade 4 complications. That's like a return to the operating room, ICU, you know, or mortality or extended length of stay. and it outperformed increasing age. And this was, you know, with 20,000 patients, which is pretty powerful. And the odds ratios, were good. And so this is when it started getting exciting, as we were getting bigger and bigger data sets and looking at big problems. This was a paper we published in JAMA last year, looking at how frailty performed better than increased age at predicting outcomes with vestibular schwannoma resection. And this ROC curve, receiver operating characteristic curve analysis in the lower right, this shows how much better the MFI is than age at predicting outcome in acoustic neuroma vestibular schwannoma patients. And so, when we looked at this large data set, frailty really determined who had postoperative complications, hemorrhage, stroke, and increasing age wasn't all that helpful. And this was a real, eye-opener, and we were really happy to be able to get it published in the JAMA Otolaryngology Journal, and kind of confirm for us that, what we were finding and that this could be, very powerful and help people counsel older patients. I particularly liked this article because I had written the one about older age when I didn't know about frailty as a younger resident during my research year. And so, this was great to see that in-hospital mortality, routine discharge, hospital length of stay, that frailty helped us predict outcomes. So this was kind of, they put on the cover of their website, and it was a figure that was really a testament for us of how powerful the MFI can be. And this is looking at in hospital mortality, looking at age and modified frailty index. And what one thing that was tricky to get the paper published was looking at race, because it turned out also that being non-white was also a an independent risk factor for poor outcomes. And so which is a whole separate area of research, which is super important. This model factored both things in and showed that was important as well. So when you look across the whole field of neurosurgery and all these diseases, none of them had, very few had frailty defined within them. So we wanted to look at frailty and outcomes of traumatic spinal cord injury. And so we got this letter published in the journal titled Neurosurgery. And then this is a manuscript we've submitted. So looking at how frailty study affects traumatic spinal cord injury patients with a huge database. And this is using a decision tree, you can follow it out for age and frailty, and it kind of can help you predict outcomes. So it's not published quite yet, but it should hopefully be accepted. I work with a lot of neuroautologists, as you can imagine, in skull base, and Dr. Gergel at Utah is a good friend of mine, and I've known him for a lot of years. And so he does a lot of research, has NIH funding with hearing and balance, and got interested in it. And so I kind of worked with his team and helped them kind of get this set up. They wrote the paper, but we helped them design the study and looking at cochlear implantation. And they were able to, get that published. We did another nationwide inpatient sample using that, and they were able to present that at their main meeting and start looking at all kind of different aspects within elective autology, which has some overlap with school base. We started writing some book chapters, looking at different options within neurosurgery. What can we do with elderly patients that are frail, and looking at prehabilitation? Can we get them outpatient, have them meet with geriatrics? Can we increase their physical activity before surgery if it's elective? And what kind of options are there? Also talking with people about just being aware of this, and sometimes not everything needs surgery. As people are getting older, and if their diseases are more serious, that may be the time to get palliative care involved earlier. It doesn't mean you're going to withdraw on them or anything, but they can have these discussions. What are the goals of care? So really within the last couple of years, as we moved over from New York to New Mexico, a lot of these papers have some lag time, and I essentially was using a lot of medical students, which I'll get to help us with this. So these are kind of where we're kind of at, right now with all these amount of projects submitted and these accepted. And on a kind of a side note, but an important part of this, I knew I couldn't, with all the other things I had to do, I couldn't write all these papers. So I really started mentoring medical students when we got to New York. And we did this 2-year kind of experiment where we basically used medical students and residents to kind of be the bulwark of our research and kind of be the close mentorship, kind of be the workhorse of it. And so this is the, you know, annual research products and oral presentation or publication. And we, from when we started this program, this intensive research initiative, where we would meet monthly with medical students, we'd mentor them with a summer program and really have them start working on what predominantly were frailty projects. And it shows the, you know, the difference before we got there until we started this 2-year intervention period. And we were able to publish this in the Journal of Postgraduate Medical Education, because it's the first kind of neurosurgery example of using this type of model or research program to really turn things around. And as we've expanded, COVID's only made this, more and more possible to do these kind of research through remotely. Everything, lectures like this, we published a paper on how COVID has increased all that capacity, but it's also made our research able to be done remotely. And our research lends itself to that well, since a lot of it's database research anyways. And a lot of these studies are set up with the similar types of stats. And so we have templates for how we set these studies up and how to look at we kind of teach the students how to do the statistical analysis, teach them how to write the papers. And it's a lot of work up front, but then we have, like, as this shows, these different pods of students that can really work on all these projects and get them out. And then this is a kind of a dashboard that we use. It's a smart sheet that we can click on everything and kind of help keep track. Since we have about 87 medical students, not all of them are super active, but a good number are, that are working on projects at any one time. I kind of had this and realized I don't really want to show their information, but this is how we, you know, this is our New Mexico. We have 37 here. We've got a bunch still in New York that, you know, I always get emailed from students in New York that want someone to work with. And I think there's a reputation that if they work with us, we'll let them be first author, and they can also, that they'll have a chance to get publications. And so we also, you know, been able to work one-on-one with a lot of students that have matched in neurosurgery, and that's been super rewarding as a result of this. Every publication we get, even if it's not, you know, Lancet, New England Journal, JAMA, it's a publication for students who are learning how to do research and are, you know, helping move the field along. And it's also showing their residencies that they can be successful with this. And so this was my first group of students when I arrived. I was there 3 years, so I met them at the end of their first year, and this is after they matched, and they did wonderful in the match at just amazing places, and felt like I was able to help in a small way, contribute to that. And so, you know, if you're going to work a ton with medical students, you're also going to work with students that aren't going to publish a ton, and that's okay too. You kind of have to enjoy it, that process, and being around students and trying to help, and it can't always be about, you know, what you're going to get out of that experience. Just being around them and it's, you got to kind of enjoy it. And then you start getting this set up where you get, you know, good students that you kind of work with them on papers, and they start getting the hang of it, and you give them an idea, and then they go run the statistical analysis, and you get texts like this: hey, this just did the redid the meningioma cohort, and everything looks, you know, it looks awesome. It's going to be a great paper. Check out these tables. And this is Dr. Syed Kazim, one of our pre-residency fellows who was with me here in New Mexico the last 2 years, year and a half, 20 months I've been here. And he has really done a ton of work with managing the medical students, because he'll have even extra meetings besides what I have, and I'll kind of we'll organize those ideas on that sheet on which is the next frailty thing we want to study, and then he'll kind of meet with the students, and, you know, then we'll get papers back and I'll edit them. But he's been absolutely instrumental in this, and this was just our publications last year as a result of all these students. You know, not obviously not one person could do all this work. It's a whole entire, you know, gigantic team effort. 32 abstracts last year, 17 at CNS and WNS. And so, you know, we are now moving on to this next phase, which I think that up to this point, we've talked about frailty and kind of what it is, and it makes sense conceptually. But as far as I'm concerned, we've barely even started doing the real research of frailty. And that's what we're starting to get to as we get to these next tiers. And the risk analysis index is what I want to talk about for a second. And there's two versions of it. There's an RAIA, which is what we can do retrospectively with database research. And then there's an RAIC, which is prospective. And this is just kind of showing frailty publications by year. So when we started this, there'd been very little that was out there, as we kind of showed earlier. And this is just showing kind of, Dr. Sivakumar touched on this too, is how much this is exploding in, you know, within neurosurgery. And we kind of timed this really well for this, because it's becoming more and more popular. These are the number of frailty scales used in neurosurgery publications last year. 20 different ones, where, as you can imagine, we're writing this paper is going to be submitted in the next 2 weeks about, it's kind of an overall meta-analysis and discussion of what's been used. I would argue that the RAIA and the RAIC are kind of where it's at right now with frailty. And the reality is none of this has been published within neurosurgery yet. but this I have Dr. Johanning, Jason Johanning and Dan Hall here at the bottom because they came and lectured to us, and I took the next slides from them. And they basically have already done all this within general surgery. And up here on the right, these are the robust people. And this is just looking as time goes on, you see how many days this is down the road. They can predict who is gonna live and survive and who is gonna, you know, probably be less likely to, based on this RAI score. And I'll go through that score with you. But essentially, it takes our team about 35 seconds to do an RAIC score. Every patient that gets consulted on by neurosurgery here or has or seen in the clinic gets an RAIC score, okay? And I'll show you kind of the blue is healthy, robust in this graph. This is looking at patients following them out since their first NSQIP eligible procedure. With this revised RAIC, they're less than 29, or you know, where they're robust patients, and then their more frail ones were this greater than 53. And you can look at the survival rates. Well, the green was awesome. Like so many people lived that had really low frailty scores. While they followed these people out, this is only a year and a half later, 30% have already have expired. So this was from a publication we did with a book chapter, but these concepts are important as you kind of considering surgery on people that are older. You know, should palliative care be involved? This is the same, they do a surgical pause. This is their slide, Dr. Johanning and Dr. Hall. This is one we published, but it's the same concept, which is before you just take people to surgery, what they did, Dr. Johanning did at his hospital in the VA in Nebraska, was they made people do a risk analysis index, and you had to have one completed before you went to the operating room. And in certain situations, you'd talk to palliative care, do prehabilitation. And so if they were not frail, if they were robust, you could just go along your way and go usual care to surgery. But you know, when you do this pause and you found out there was an issue, sometimes that'd be non-operative management, sometimes that'd be prehabilitation. And the bottom is Dr. Hall's group at Pittsburgh. When they started initiating a frailty screening, this is the observed over expected mortality rates just dropped. And Dr. Johanning in Nebraska, they had a similar thing happen where they started implementing that program. Their observed versus expected mortality, you know, once they started frailty screening, really made a huge difference. Just the process of asking people to put the score down and think about it made a big difference. And I'm not going to spend all day talking about the general surgery data, but it's well established. These are published in JAMA, you know, surgery, the real papers written in awesome journals, and just showing that the risk analysis index, the RAI, was associated very strongly and is very discriminative for postoperative complications, including, you know, mortality, failure to rescue. And if you look at this particular graph, the robust people down here, you know, their mortality rate without complication would be very low. Even if they get a complication, they have a low mortality rate at 30 days. Well, it starts to increase as you get multiple complications. If you have more than three or more complications, you know, a quarter of them are going to pass away. Well, if it's a frail patient and you got three or more complications, you're upwards of 50% for mortality. And just if you have zero complications or, you know, zero major complications, except for mortality, your mortality rate is still almost a 1 in 3 if their frailty score was really high, greater than 40. Okay. So robust have a low RAI score, frail have a high RAI score, and it's very, very powerful. It's much more discriminative than the MFI. So they published in JAMA Surgery in 2017, right? That's about the same month I heard my lecture on this topic of just frailty in general. They had published their results of their frailty screening initiative, looking not just at 30-day survival like we've been doing with our MFIs, but actually following these out 30, 180, 365 days. And they would flag anyone who had an RAI score greater than 21. And they saw that their 30-day mortality rate really decreased for all these surgical patients, went from 1.6% to 0.7, and that the improvement was the biggest seen amongst frail patients. So by screening, they made a huge difference. And so it became, you know, very clear to me as I transitioned from New York to New Mexico, and we'd started, you know, dabbling in all these different areas within frailty, that this risk analysis index was the way to go, that this was really what frailty screening and frailty scales were about. And it was much more powerful than just the MFI-5, which is what everything switched over to in 2014, because that's what was automatically, or 2015, that was automatically what was in the computer for the NSQIP. You couldn't even do an MFI-11 anymore. So once you're an MFI-5, you're really not using a frailty scale. Now it'll still be predictive because it's capturing major morbidities. Congestive heart failure is a major morbidity. So is, you know, impaired sensorium, these different things. So diabetes, hypertension. So the risk analysis index though is far superior And it's been shown throughout, that was just a small sampling of the general surgery, you know, trauma literature. So this is a couple papers that we are just, that are not in press yet. So this is kind of where the, I think the neurosurgery is all heading, and we're certainly writing all the papers that we just wrote with the MFI. We're redoing them all with the art risk analysis index. And I think it's much more powerful. This is looking at major outcomes stratified by age, looking at comparing the RAIA to MFI-5 frailty score for all brain tumors in the NSQIP database in a recent series, 2015-2019, with 31,000 patients. And as you can see, these RAI scores are super predictive of mortality, and the not frail and pre-frail, you know, doesn't make as much of a difference. But sometimes with these, with the, these are going off of MFI, with the MFI, it can be not quite as linear or stepwise, and it tends to be more stepwise, we found so far with the RAI score, and that you can kind of see major complication. There's this nice and kind of incremental growth. And obviously we're still, you know, brand new at looking at this. Clavien Dindo grade 4 complications, return to ORs, ICU. We have this nice kind of linear stepwise, you know, growth rate, but it's more predictive in our hands. We found it to be more helpful than just the MFI scale for extended length of stay, non-routine discharge, same things. This is the multivariate analysis, odds ratios for all major outcomes using the RAI and the MFI-5. Here's your MFI scores. And you can see with MFI-5 scores of 1, 2, or 3 and above, the odds ratios are not as powerful. So these are much more discriminant, and they're much more powerful and much more predictive for all the major outcomes here for mortality. Well, having an RAI score of 40 or more is a big deal. And you can see these odds ratios, how much more powerful they are than just the MFI 1, 2, or 3. Same thing with major complication, far superior to it with much higher odds ratios and confidence intervals are better. Clavien Dindo grade 4 complications, extended length of stays, non-routine discharges. This is another paper we're submitted. It's not quite impressed yet, but 300,000 spine patients using the NSQIP database from 2015-2019. Same thing, mortality. Look at this RAI of 36 and above. And for spine patients, no patient should die within 30 days of surgery if you can avoid it, But this is kind of showing us that maybe we might be able to avoid it. Look at the odds ratio differences between an MFI-5 score of 3 is super high. That is a severely frail patient by that old system, but the discriminative ability of that versus this is night and day. Same thing with extended length of stay, non-routine discharges. So we're getting a better sense of what we kind of think of as phenotypical frailty, people that are really, really frail. So in the last few minutes here, this is the RAIC score. When I arrived, Dr. McKee and myself and Dr. Kazim, our pre-residency fellow, started putting this into power chart where there's a dot phrase. And so we do this for every consultation, every admission, and every outpatient clinic patient gets an RAIC score. And you go through, you know, do you live at home or you live in a facility? Do you have these such and such medical conditions, CHF, renal failure? And there's points associated with all these. And a big part of it is how is your ability to ambulate and take care of yourself, ADLs. If you're dependent on others, you're gonna get 4, 8, 12, 16 points on that. If you have cancer, you get a bunch of points. And this is how it looks in power chart. It's a dot phrase for us. And the whole hospital now is using this, and we wrote the IRB for the hospital. And we've been accruing this data for over a year and a half now. And as you can imagine, we go back to that pyramid. The next part of papers we're gonna be publishing is the RAIC prospective one, which has never been published in neurosurgery. And we've already taken a kind of a look at some of that, and it looks really good. And so we're excited about that. If you have cancer, when you're scoring somebody, let's say they're 80 and they have cancer, well, they get 35 points right off the bat. And if they're 80 without cancer, you know, then they get 9 points less. So that's a big deal. Weight loss gets you 4, poor appetite 4, renal failure 8, CHF 5. And then if they have cognitive impairment, you get higher points than if they didn't. When you add these ADLs up, if they're totally dependent, they get 16, you know, and so if they were not independent, if they were not dependent at all, they're totally normal, then we would get 0 for that. If we had no cognitive impairment, we'd get 0, but if we had cognitive impairment, we'd get 5. So it starts counting points that way, and you add them all up, and we've been using this REDCap survey ever since we got here and are looking forward to publishing 2-year data on that prospectively collected. So the last few minutes here, just looking at some cases. You know, there was a patient that was 57 years old, came in, and this guy was really sick. He had BNP of 900, D-dimer was 5,000, his sodium was 156, his BUN and creatinine were acutely 91 over 7.3. He was an inmate, His AST was 318, ALT was 214. You know, this guy was really ill, and he was found to have, you know, left sigmoid and jugular sinus thrombosis from this, you know, underlying malignancy, because he was found on his Frailty score was 61. It's like one of the highest ones I've ever seen. And he had these lesions in his brain, and they wanted us to like treat him, but he was on like a heparin drip for his, you know, sinus thrombosis. And I mean, this guy was really, really ill. And anesthesia, you know, in our institution was, and in medicine, everyone's like, oh, neurosurgery just needs to take him to the OR. And they're like, you know, there's not much we can do to work him up or to optimize him. And so we basically, they'd cleared him for surgery more or less. I wasn't comfortable with it. I thought he was going to do terrible and that they needed to try to like optimize him, get some of his renal failure issues under control. And I said, see if you guys can tune him up and reconsult us, give us some time and see if you can get him better. And then we'll operate on him. If you guys can kind of correct some of this. Well, they couldn't really correct him. And the guy ended up, dying. And I think that was unfortunate, but I don't think we could have like fixed him. And I think he would have definitely been a, you know, surgical complication. I don't think we would have helped him at all. This was a patient that had to have had a primary neurological disorder, because this is a decent, it's an okay size meningioma, but their presentation didn't really fit. They were having all kinds of cognitive issues. They had difficulty ambulating, and it was just nothing that seemed to be correlated to this meningioma. But family got upset, and you know, we scored this patient, and their Frailty score is 42. In this case, you know, family got involved, was adamant that no matter what, we operate. And I told him, I don't think it was gonna get better. I think he was risky because of his impairment. But I, you know, at the end of the day, we're very rarely gonna refuse at all costs to operate on somebody. We just were very good about documenting with this. And they were upset when, you know, we weren't operating on him, we'd go and see the patient, and he was completely, you know, septic essentially at this time. These are some notes about people get very angry sometimes if you don't offer surgery. But so this is kind of throughout medicine, we have to kind of change the culture where every single patient, no matter what, needs a surgery every single time. This was him the day they were really upset we weren't taking him to the OR, but he literally met serious criteria and went into the ICU after we came up and assessed him. And they wanted us to take him that day, take his meningioma out. For the sake of time, the last couple minutes, I'll skip it, but he was gurgly. He was like,
hey, how are you? Come on.
He was hypotensive, need to get put on pressors. And, you know, this is a lot of like discussions with the other teams about this. And I tried to get anesthesia to assess him, and they said, oh, you know, there's nothing more we can do to get him better. Well, the guy ended up getting trach and pegged. The surgery was simple, took 2 hours. The guy did fine. That wasn't even the issue. But then he couldn't wean him off the ventilator. He wasn't protecting his airway well, you know, great earlier. I'm going to skip some of these, but it's the same kind of thing over and over, which is, I think as surgeons, we have a huge responsibility to make sure that patients we take to the operating room do well, and that we don't do anyone, you know, any favors when we take people to the operating room and they don't survive that 30 days. And it's not just the surgery. A lot of times the surgery goes fine. I did, and then they, you know, the patient discharges even, doing okay, but they bounce back with other, you know, with other issues, or they bounce back from rehab. And so, you know, I love this quote. Marsh used it in his book, but it comes originally from, you know, Rene LaRiche. Every surgeon carries about him a cemetery in which from time to time he goes to pray, a cemetery of bitterness and regret, of which he seeks the reason for certain of his failures. You know, with everything we do, there are times where it's better not to operate than it is to have somebody, you know, go to the operating room and have a major complication and die. And I think that's something within neurosurgery that we have to culturally accept and try to do a better job of predicting, giving people more accurate risk assessments. And it's really a question of what's your philosophy. I call this the kind of my own idea of it, but it's the Price is Right showcase principle, you know, which is what's your acceptable standard for being wrong and someone dying as a result of surgery? Because for me, I want that to be really low. I want very few people to be in that particular cemetery for me.
Kelsey. $2,500 in cash, a trip to Oregon, and a trip to Japan in a showcase. You've been $22,500. Actual retail price? $22,498. You're over by two.
You only missed it by $2, but if that patient dies, that's still a major, major, major thing. I had a patient recently that was 82. She had an enhancing lesion. It was a small tumor. I thought it was either a MET or a glioblastoma, suspicious of glioblastoma, some necrosis. She didn't want to have surgery. By the time she got to me, it had been 3 weeks. I said, well, let's just redo an MRI next week and we'll see you back and talk about it. It had grown and it looked more like a glioblastoma. And she was robust. She was super healthy. We operated on her and she did great. She went home day two like a 30-year-old. Well, 4 days later, she comes back in status and she had to be intubated, sedated for a few days on all these medications. Her seizures, it wasn't even related to the occipital side. It was in her temporal lobe. Her seizures were under control, but the family said she wouldn't want to go through rehab. She was adamant about that and they ended up withdrawing on her. Well, that lady, I mean, I didn't do her any favors and she wasn't particularly fond of surgery anyways. Now, I don't think I could have done anything more. It was a very quick case. We frailty screened her. You know, sometimes things like that happen, but I certainly feel better when I know I've done everything I can to screen them out. And so the final kind of thought here, you know, when Coronado and his group came through the Southwest, they were trying to find these cities of gold, the cities of El Dorado and Cibola. And what the ironic part about this is they introduced something to the people that were there that ended up being far more valuable than cities of gold. The tribes that were there, the Navajo and the Comanche, the Navajo got introduced to the Churro sheep from Spain, and the Spanish also introduced the horse. And this ties into our California history. Spain and then subsequently Mexico invited Americans into Texas predominantly to be a buffer to the Comanche, who were the ultimate horse warriors and were unbelievably powerful, but they essentially managed an empire here. And that is the only reason that Mexico had Texans come in and get into settling all of Texas, was to be a buffer for the Comanche so they would protect Mexico because it was constantly being raided. And this ended up being that although Coronado and his group were looking for these golden cities, the horse that they introduced to the Comanche led to their complete domination of the plains and establishing this empire that had a direct consequence on manifest destiny and American settling of the entire Southwest. And for the Navajo, the most expensive garment in the world was the Navajo chief's blankets. A U.S. captain in 1864 made $1 to $2 a month. And these blankets would cost $100, four entire year salary of a U.S. Captain in the military at that time. And so the wealth was immense from the Comanche. And these were the finest, you know, most expensive garments because they wore these as blankets, in the world. And it came out from the introductions that the Spaniards themselves brought when they were looking for the seven cities of gold. And I think it does speak also to using the resources we have and putting effort in and making things, you know, better. They called them chief blankets because it was other tribes who usually only the chief of each of these other tribes on the plains could have one because they're so expensive. This is a picture of my family. The reason I do what I do is I want to help make people better and I want to be able to help patients have better outcomes. And I think this frailty research does a good job of that for these older patients when we're kind of stuck trying to figure out what the best thing is to do. I'm going to skip the rest of this, but just to conclude, frailty is an emerging field, but it's super important. And I think that as we develop it further and further, we're going to have a much better idea and ability to be able to predict for older patients what they should do when they face these moments. So thanks for your time. Thanks for listening. And if there's any time for questions, I'd love to take them.
Christian, thank you very much. That was captivating. And like we mentioned at the beginning, I think this is going to be a major, major aspect of not just all neuroscience care, but all of medical care. We're probably actually late to the game here. Had a couple of things here I wanted to chat about. There's a couple of questions. I wanted to start and then talk about this sort of lens well into a lot of the work that we've been talking about and discussing over the last couple of years on enhanced recovery after surgery. And I know you're basically leading up to the prehabilitation part of it, but I thought it would be interesting to bring in Dr. Neil Martin to say a couple of words here because he's been leading a lot of our efforts on those regards, and frailty plays a key role in all of that. So Dr. Martin, would you?
Happy to, Wally. First of all, that was a fascinating fascinating presentation and a wonderful body of work. And I think that's going to be extremely important for us to incorporate in our patient assessment activities, especially when contemplating major surgery. So I think it's going to help us be more thoughtful about who gets surgical and who gets non-surgical treatment. And I think that we need to do a couple things. One is that for many patients with surgical lesions, surgery is not the best option. There are alternatives in many, many of the disorders that we treat. And so what I've found in my career is that very often it's extremely difficult to tell a patient or their family that surgery could be done, but you're not going to do it. Yeah. And part of the experiential learning is that that's the wrong way to present it. The right way to present it is not to say we're not going to do surgery. It's to say surgery is not going to help. And when I started using that phrase instead, I found a much higher degree of patient acceptance when they understood that there are other alternatives and surgery has a major downside in some patients. So just the approach to a patient and their family can make a big difference, and you can eliminate that back and forth arguing if you just say surgery is not going to help. You don't have to get into every nuance about the quantitative score of the ROI, your RAI or whatever, but that's one observation. The second thought I have is, Wally, we should start incorporating this right away, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Data is very compelling. Mm-hmm. And the real question is, can you do something about a bad RAI score to make it better? Is it possible in a week or 2 weeks to quantitatively significantly improve the score? Number one, is that possible? And the second question is, if you improve the score, do you change their outcome? And I think that's really where we need to go with this. You know, we need to be much, much more sophisticated with our, quote, prehabilitation or medical optimization or nutritional optimization before surgery. So I think that's a whole entire field that is open for investigation. I mean, certainly there's data out there that if that smoking cessation reduces perioperative risk. And there's some data out there that nutritional optimization reduces perioperative risk. But I think this is the real frontier, because as you pointed out at the beginning, we're going to be seeing more and more elderly patients, and we'll have the surgical techniques and the technology to deal effectively with the lesion. But if the stress on the patient so much that they have a bad outcome, we can't, you know, and they die of congestive heart failure in 3 months, we can't shrug our shoulders and say, well, that wasn't a surgical complication. So, I think this is a critically important area. I think it's another step towards, you know, optimizing our results and improving our ability to select the appropriate therapy, and even pointing us to ways where we can improve the patient's odds of a great outcome. So I think it's extremely important, very impressive. Wally, thank you for arranging this, and thanks for the great work that's been done here. I think this is, you know, I think this is a major step forward for us.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Martin. A couple of things in the audience. Dr. Amir Bokshar brought up, you know, excellent talk, and it really applies well with deciding on major spine surgery, particularly deformity. And Christian, Gian, and I saw that on a daily basis when we were in training, about how much work and how much discussion went into planning for those surgeries. You know, oftentimes we're talking about months on months and on months of discussions and optimization. I think it goes into what the precursor to formal prehabilitation is going to look like. Do you have anything to say on that?
So I think, you know, this is just kind of how I framed this, but I think Dr. Martin and the other commenter make a good point, which maybe prehabilitation doesn't have to be at the top of the pyramid. It's kind of how I wanted to define everything, but we already know for stuff like deformity, they have their own, you know, disease-specific frailty scale they came up with. It needs to be validated still, but I think there's definitely times where, you know, we might be able to start doing that now. And I'm not, you know, I like researching in all these things, and we're submitting these like RAI papers for spine for this basic degenerative things. But I think there's work we could start doing right away. I like this one in particular that we're submitting. that looks at how discriminatory this can be to help. But I think patients that a deformity surgery, as we all know, is about the most invasive, difficult surgery there is. So I don't know that we need to wait, to get on this. And I'm not as familiar with the ERAS because this pretty much, takes up 24/7. I work all the time. I come home, try and see the kids, and then I work on this, most evenings. And there's so much work to do just with defining all these things. That's kind of where my focus has been. But I think to your guys' point, I like how Dr. Martin was phrasing, these discussions with family. We're starting a frailty indications conference here because Dr. Martin hit it right on the head. It's hard to tell families no to something. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to get our colleagues with anesthesia, our colleagues with the surgeons to be able to go back to families and say, I think what Dr. Martin said best is, we've talked about this as a group with our anesthesia colleagues, and we don't think, I know you're miserable from your deformity, but we don't think we can help you. I think that's a good way of putting it versus what Dr. Martin said, we're not going to do surgery. That's a, that's a tough way to phrase it. But I think as we improve this data of getting this more and more defined, that's going to make it easier for everybody to be, not to show them the data, but that we know it better and that we feel more confident in it.
We've been doing a lot of work recently on developing a geriatric enhanced recovery protocol after surgery. And it sort of hits a lot of the different aspects that you've been alluding to that are shown up over and over again in all of the different frailty indices. One of those that I didn't see much of, I may have missed it. Was there any discussion here on the level of sleep disturbance in patients? I'm sure I missed it because that's a huge topic as of late.
There's tons of scales out there. I think I showed that slide that in the neurosurgery literature, we've got, in the last, when we did this analysis, this literature review, those are the scales people are using for mm-hmm. frailty within neurosurgery. So it's not standardized. I don't specifically know of one, but I'll tell you what, I did a pituitary patient that was on oxygen and his score wasn't even the biggest thing, but I was like, are you on oxygen all the time? He's like, well, I use it at night, this and that. It was a simple pituitary case. He wasn't even able to extubate afterwards. It was a large pituitary tumor, but it wasn't excessive. He ended up going to rehab and he ended up getting respiratory failure in rehab. This is like way later.
Yeah.
And he ended up passing away. And so I think pulmonary pathology is one of the worst things. And this RAI is great, but I don't think it's going to necessarily even be the final version of what we use. I think there's other things that we can factor in. And I think this is where it gets into disease specific things. The deformity surgeons can probably, tell us specific things on that. But I think pulmonary pathology is always going to be a major driver of prediction. Yeah. So anything you can do to optimize, prehabilitate the lungs. People use scales where they look at their hand grip strength and their lung function, and then they try and go bulk them up and like get them working on that. It's nice if it's an elective situation, you have a lot of time. We haven't defined it yet for neurosurgery, but people are looking at it. The trick is to kind of use the general surgery trauma literature. The American College of Surgeons has this great group with Dan Holm, Joe Hanning, where they do a lot of this awesome work. And it was kind of shocking to me when I stumbled onto it, because I've been trying to like research topics like this before, and it really just changed the whole trajectory. But I think there's tons of work to do, and I think there's so much for everyone to contribute.
Wally, it's going to be important going forward, and Christian, to define in terms of prehabilitation or optimization, what, as you said, it's conceivable that you can do something significant in an elective case where you have 2 to 4 weeks to intervene. The real question is, how much can you accomplish by what technique in 1 week? Mm-hmm. Or 2 days to bring to a patient who's deteriorating every day, or the intracerebral hemorrhage case where you have 12 hours. What can you do with different time intervals to optimize their outcome? And that's a whole, maybe the NISQIP team has some ideas about that. We should definitely investigate that, but that's really the critical question. And it's you're not going to do smoking cessation in somebody with an intracerebral hemorrhage. Mm-hmm. But is there anything you can do? Can you give something pharmacologically to neutralize nicotine? Or I don't know. We're going to have to come up with some innovative risk elimination strategies that can be applied given the clinical circumstance and its urgency. Anyway, thanks. Very thought-provoking.
Thanks for your comments. I really appreciate it.
So if there are no other questions, thank you everybody who's, Dr. McIntyre, there may be an opportunity to incorporate these scales to identify patients, frail patients that are less than 65 for some of these ERAS programs to help them do better, but would have been missed by age-based identification schemes. Yeah, very great, great.
I may not have explained that very well, but we don't use age for, when we're doing these studies, we're not cutting them off at 65. Mm-hmm. So we're doing everybody. And the argument I tell people is that 89-year-old, you know, he's robust, but there might be a 55 or a 59 or 64-year-old on the couch with all kinds of, you know, frail score points that all these things, pulmonary pathology, renal disease, they're the frail ones. So the age doesn't even, I started it with age in mind because a lot of older patients are frail, but it is not an age-based cutoff for us at AME. I think there's lots of young people that fall into that group.
Thought-provoking, Christian, as always. Thank you very much for doing this.
Thanks for having me.
We'll talk offline here, but we're definitely going to incorporate some of this work as we develop our program.
It takes about 35 to 40 seconds per consult, and our MAs do it in the clinic, and we don't even have a residency. We hopefully will get it back in April. The site visit went well, but our PAs do it on the wards and in the ER. Yeah. And it gets a dot phrase that drops right into the note, and it goes right into REDCap for our study. It's super easy, and we're happy to help anyway. Let me know to go through it with whoever. But we just made it all automated. And you guys probably have Epic, which is even better than, you know, PowerChart, which we use for it.
No, we'll definitely talk here. With that, Happy New Year again to everyone. Thank you for coming and your continued support. We'll be back the second week, the second Tuesday in February. With the talk to be discussed. If you guys have any requests or suggestions, please feel free to contact me. Dr. Bowers, thank you very much again. That was incredible. And have a happy and safe week, everyone.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate you guys.